Live, going live, going live. And you're live.
Hey, Internet.
Hey.
Nice, relaxing Tuesday here.
Send the live.
I try to sound like Ozzy. Just like
Ozzy.
Just like, wow. So relaxing.
I was checking again the...
I need that as a ringtone.
Two episodes ago, you were doing the whole Bill Clinton voice. I missed that one a little bit.
Oh, yeah. That's, you know, when your voice gets kind of raggedy, it's always easier to do it.
All right, we got people in.
Rest in peace, Phil Hartman.
Let's see. We got VC Gesture, friend of the show, BC Gesture, Boria Zero, Bob Jones, Matt, Eskimonster, Ziv. Hello, hello. How's the audio sounding for us? Please let us know. Looking good. Hey, Gordon, have you ever done karaoke before? Yeah, just like at a bar or, you know, those very Asian karaoke rooms. I went to one this weekend. with some friends. And have you been to?
I've never actually, because they look really sketchy to me. I'm sorry, because like I have actually done karaoke at, it was a conference.
Oh.
And then like we all got up there with our teacher. And our professor, and we were singing Elvis or something like that. It was bizarre, but I've never gone to what you're talking about, because it really feels like there's some kind of, it's got a really kind of sketch feeling. Sorry.
To it. You've been to one.
No, I've seen it from the outside. Like I ain't going in. It's like, wait, so you go, for people who don't know, you'll go to like some strip mall and there'll be, you know, a storefront, and then inside there's like a your reception area, and then there's all these kind of like walled off rooms, you know, like private.
Yeah.
Like, what's up with that? Like, what's going on there? I'm not gonna like.
So your party can just, you know, sing
sure.
along without.
Sure.
Cause versus,
Willis.
Versus. Yes. I mean, have you been? How about your karaoke bars? Or yeah, karaoke bars out in the open, sing to strangers. You've done that. You said you've been.
So I have never personally done that. I have seen it,
but
so.
you've been to one. You listen. You did. you ever participate?
No, because I mean, except for that one time in a conference. No, because I mean, no. But like, okay, that's one thing in the open. But it just feels like, I don't know. Am I gonna like? You're gonna wake up in a bathtub full of ice. It's just kind of scary. You don't.
But you're in a room with people you know. You're not, you know.
No, I have never done it. And I, you know, so there's an interesting thing. This is actually, by the way, Happy New Year to Gung Hei Fa Chai for Lunar New Year, folks. Elena should be into this. But so we would usually go to these family banquets.
Uh-huh.
So it's like you basically get like 300, 400 people in this big banquet room. There'd be food, all that. And then if it's really old time, you get, it was always... the elders, and it would be this big to do. They'd have the sashes on, there'd be tons of flowers. And then maybe about 10, 12 years ago, it used to be like, just have food and everybody's just talking. Somebody got the bright idea to introduce karaoke into it. And so you'd be in this room and it'd be a banquet hall. There'd be 500 people in it. And then you would just have the absolute worst karaoke in the world, because it was just basically people who are off key or just the worst singers in the world. And then they'd be singing karaoke in Chinese.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then because everybody's, I mean, you know, I don't know what it is, but it's like, could you turn the sound down? Cause like your ears would hurt because the sound would be turned up so loud. You're supposed to try to enjoy this meal. And you got somebody who's, and we're, my sister and I would always say, like, it sounds like somebody's killing a cat, right? It really does. And then you'd get the cat killing, and then to be some dude who's like been like professionally studying singing for like, and then now here's his chance to sing. And then like, you'd go,
but it's family, Gordon. It's family. And also, not to mention, like, I think at banquets like those, I usually just eat.
It's kind
I just
of family. But let me tell you, that is so no. There's just, I'm sorry. It's just nothing. I guess there's some kind of things like, if you could disinvent, maybe it would be the karaoke machine, because then you wouldn't suffer like that.
Oh, yeah. Ryuzu right. points out that it's like, yeah, restaurants probably can sell more booze to drown out the terrible singing.
I guess so. Really, like, we got to the point where we would actually bring ear protection for our kids because it was so loud. And then we'd talk to the waiter and they would turn it down. And then about 20 minutes later, somebody would like, oh, turn it up because the people like, they can't hear. It's like, hell, they can't hear you down the block, lady.
But is it at a banquet that you're attending or you're at a restaurant where the next door has
No, it's built into the banquet. Like, oh, and now we will have the torturing singing because it would be bad. I should record it next time because it's just like, it is horrible. We actually do have computer stuff to talk about. Yes, we do. We are stalling because we're waiting for Lena to show up. You can see on the left of us, we have a laptop that has Intel's, in fact, this is the laptop I did all the testing on, an MSI, I always get it backwards, Titan GT77, Intel Core i9-13980HX with GeForce RTX 4090 laptop GPU in it. There's actually a story on PC World's website, as well as two videos, one covering the GPU performance, one covering the CPU performance. We're going to talk about that, but we're kind of stalling, hopefully, to get Elena to show up.
Elena.
But we're talking, she's going to be sad. We're like, oh, I do want to hear her opinions on the karaoke, because I want to know if that's like a common...
And I'm only bringing this up because, like, I was like hoping we can do that at Computex. Come in, you know, end of May when we do go, because we're going to Taiwan. It's huge. KTV is huge in Asia and Taiwan nonetheless. So I was like, maybe our friends over at MSI will bring us to it, you know, to karaoke. I'll ask I'll ask the staff at MSI. They'll say, hey, you know, I'm gonna say Gordon wants to sing karaoke. Just bring us over to
someone after the show. It's here. Not. I just think no. It's just. No, I just don't. I don't understand. I don't understand. I just don't get it. I mean, is it because is you just testing the limits of personal friendship and people just saying, man, just stop singing because you suck, right? Because it's terrible. If you were a good singer, you would actually be paid to be on stage. So please, I don't get it. I don't understand it. We actually have a $5
super chat.
Is that what they're called? Super chat from. Professor Frag, we need rigorous benchmarks of Apple Silicon versus Wintel. I think that's unfair because that does not include AMD. Basically, Apple Silicon versus x86 gaming creating productivity. You're the right nerds for the job. I am actually in the process of looking at some of that on a MacBook. It's not quite the tippy top of the MacBook world, but. It's interesting so far. I unfortunately don't have the results today because I'm still in the middle of testing that, and I'm actually going to be comparing similar class laptops because I think, you know, I've mentioned the performance of this laptop in Geekbench and the OpenCL performance, and I think I triggered somebody who's a MacBook Pro M2 person. It's already because, you know, we were just saying like, hey, here's how much the score is in Metal versus what we're seeing. For the M2 Metal, and they're like, hey, you unplug it. Yeah, okay, but when it's plugged in, this is the score, correct? And it's just clearly the, you can only use the test parameters that favor my team to show that we're winning. If you use anything else, that's just simply, I'm going to say something terrible.
So Team Windows versus Team Apple.
yeah, no, it's, no. I mean, I will say it's exactly what you would expect. There's definitely some things where it gets its nose punched in. So, but you know, I'm still haven't really gotten to all the sort of important stuff yet. And, it'll take a lot longer. I figure I'm going to do it as part one, part two, because I honestly do think, when you get to a thin and light laptop, battery life does matter more, you know, actually disconnected performance does matter more. Of course, that means more testing. And then you've got to charge the battery up, and how exactly are you going to measure the battery consumption? You know, I know how to do that on Windows. I don't really know how to do that on the Mac. Cause I mean, mm-hmm. One of the ways I've done before for lighter laptops is I look at actually power used from the battery. Cause I think that's basically a good tell, like how much gas you're draining out of the tank. I don't know how to do that on the Mac. So I'll have to figure that out. But I do think there's going to be strengths and weaknesses of both platforms, and honestly, it really comes down to you want to buy the best Windows PC laptop for your needs, and you and the other one is like you want to buy the best Mac laptop for your needs, because I think it's just they're no longer the same. We're going down different paths. So still good to know.
But I think people are just more familiar. Like they don't want, they just into the whole ecosystem. Like I've been with Apple for so long, it's like I think I'm just gonna ride and stick with it.
Yeah, no, yeah. And there's nothing wrong with that, to be honest, because yeah. Why would you? I think that's the problem, and I was railing against, because I trying to navigate the Mac OS is for me very painful, because I'm Windows. Honestly, the Mac OS is so hard to use. Like, oh my God, Windows 11 is not that bad, actually. Going like, because at least some things are familiar in Windows 11. It is just simply alien to me to use the Mac OS, because it's just, unless you use it all the time, you don't understand how it works. Like a trackpad, it's very confusing, because you've got that multi-touch level, and you know it's binary for us. You push down, it's push. But on the Mac, it's like, oh, I can't, you know. It really is just simply, I would describe it as you drive on the left side of the road, I drive on the right side. And I would be scared as hell to go 85 miles an hour down the left side of the road in my car, because I just feel like I'm going to steer into a truck, right? It's just weird.
Or you just go local and just slowly learn.
But you know, I think the problem is everybody just wants to scream that their team is better. My team is better than your team. Ha ha, look at that. And it's just like, again, this is just hardware people want to sell you.
Yeah.
Buy the right tool for what it is, and just don't get caught up in all the drama of it all. So
we got a friend, Tech with Sean, says, I use both, no problem every day. It's just like anything else. You just have to get acclimated to it.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's what it comes down to, right? Because I'm sure you agree, if you don't use it and you try to use it, it's like, it really is confusing as hell.
Yeah.
And of course, the person who uses it every day will always, oh, well, it's so intuitive to use. Yeah, it's intuitive for you because you've used it for 10 years. It's actually not intuitive at all. And then for that Mac person to go to Windows, it's not intuitive at all either, right? Because it's like if they've never used Windows, it just comes down to a different thing. Don't just stop screaming about it. That's my whole thing, because it's just, these are just simply products by for-profit companies that want to sell you something. So, you know, take a step back, buy the thing that works for you. All right.
I guess we'll come on later on, but we can get kickstarted first.
We'll kickstart it. I'll have to pretend I'm Elena when I will introduce her. Hopefully she does show up and I'm not wrong. Yeah. Where are my notes here? Oh, here we go right here. Tell me when you're ready.
Okay, let's see. Right. Okay, good. Go ahead.
In this episode of Full Nerd, Intel and NVIDIA are in charge of laptops. Welcome to episode 247 of The Full Nerd. I'm your host, Gord Mong, with Elena Yee, who will be on the screen hopefully later on. Hey, there's no value. I'm just going to say that because I'm sure that's what she would say to anything. And Willis Lai is controlling the vertical and horizontal.
Hello, hello, everyone. I am in charge of the of the producer chair today in my coop. Adam's MIA today, so we're taking over the show.
Yeah, and I do have permission from Adam to share his status, and I'm pretend this is the post-game podium where I'm coach, any coach of any basketball team speaking to the camera. Well, it turns out Adam has a knee problem. He's actually getting some surgery for today. He'll be out for a few games, but the good news is we think we'll have him back for the playoffs. We'll have to play it day by day. It'll be up to medical staff, but we're certain we'll have him back for the playoffs, and we're going to make a run. We're going to make a run.
Totally,
this year.
Totally.
So.
All right.
Today,
what is exciting stuff today, Gordon? What do we have?
We're going to be talking about the launch day, of course, for reviews for Intel's new 13th gen CPUs. What we're seeing today is the high end for the 13th gen HX, as well as NVIDIA's highly anticipated GeForce RTX 40 series GPUs. There's actually a video you can look at on PC World's YouTube on both the CPU and GPU. We actually decided to break into two different videos to make it easier for you to follow the path you want. You obviously cannot divorce those two parts from each other, so they play into it. You also cannot buy, like, hey, a 40 series with an older CPU. I doubt. That's just simply the way it works. There's also a story on PC World that Elena actually read after sort of ingesting all of the benchmarks. I encourage you to also read that as well. We're actually going to go over some of the numbers here, but I don't want to just drop the bomb of benchmark charts on you. We got that on video. You can review the tape. We got Ripley's tape on disc. You can review that yourself. But I'm gonna throw out a couple things here. Where should we start, Willis? I think we're going to start off with Cinebench, right?
Yeah.
Let's see. We do single threaded. We'll kick it off with single threaded. So the 1T Cinebench.
All right. Sure. One second here.
So, right. For people who don't know, these are the results of this MSI, I'm going to say it right, Titan GT77. The full name is HX13V. It's basically it's a big, bold 7.5-pound laptop that is a desktop replacement class. I compared this to the previous Titan GT77 using the older 12th gen Core i9-12900HX and a GeForce RTX 3080 Ti laptop GPU versus this one, which has, of course, the Core i9-13980HX with an RTX 4090 laptop GPU. The good thing about doing this is they both had 32 gigs of RAM. They're also basically the same chassis, so the internals could be a little different. I know the cooling on this laptop is a little bit different than the previous one, but you're actually getting like for like laptop. They were also both running Windows 11 H222, whatever it is, I can't remember. So basically like for like, similar platforms. It gets really weird. Like if I were to try to compare this to, say, a Razer Blade 16, which is much smaller, much lighter, you're definitely going to give up some cooling performance versus this. So you're actually seeing like for like performance. And let's on Cinebench, there's actually, of course, we have results for Blender, V-Ray, all that other good stuff that you want to see. But Cinebench is actually very useful. It is not, of course, the only benchmark to look at, but it is a useful tool because everybody can run it. Everybody's familiar with it. I think most people are kind of understand how it scales really well. With cores, I know if you had Ian from Tech Potato, it's like, this is like, it's not really doing a lot that's really pushing things, but it is a benchmark that you can be familiar with. I think he'd say one criticism is it's very cache heavy, but the performance in single threaded, again, which 12th gen HX was very nice at. And by the way, if you haven't kept up on current events, 12th gen HX was basically taking the 12th gen desktop part, putting it into a BGA package, soldering it to a motherboard, you know, futzing with it to basically make a desktop Alder Lake CPU run in a desktop. You know, basically Intel says, we're just going to go for it. We don't care about all that battery stuff. We're just going to go for all out performance. It's actually, when it came out, extremely impressive. Very big performance jumps, and we can see 1875 for the older Core i9 12th gen versus 2137. It's basically 14% faster in single threaded performance in Cinebench. That's the default 10-minute run. I'd say that's a pretty, you know, decent increase, especially when you're looking at single threaded, because the only way you're really getting it is to change the microarchitecture, or in this case, give more power, run the clocks up, and they are running the clocks up on the Core i9-13980HX to give it a 14% increase in performance over the previous 12th gen, top-end 12th gen part. So pretty damn good. But, you know, again, 14th gen, I think some people, Adam was saying, that doesn't sound that impressive. I'm like, that is pretty good. Of course, where you get your like, I'm impressed, I would think is the performance of the next chart, Willis. We go to Cinebench R23.
Right.
So we're going to be looking at Cinebench R23 NT, basically multi-core performance. Let me know when it's up.
Yep. It's up.
And this is the thing you kind of want to see, like, oh, this is like, oh, exciting, right? Because you're looking at a 40% increase in performance going from the 16-core i9-12900HX versus the 24-core i9-13980HX. So it's actually kind of, I would say generally we kind of saw that same thing when we saw Alder Lake to Raptor Lake desktop. 40% is nothing to squeeze to sneeze at, especially like you just like, did I say what the hell? Is nothing to you just can't like just don't dismiss it, because 40% improvement in multi-core performance
still significant, you
know? Is extremely significant, right? Yeah. That is, you know, Raptor Lake is for the most part, you know, very similar to Alder Lake, so not a huge change. But Intel basically saying we're going to give you your 8 performance cores, but instead of giving you 8 efficiency cores that Alder Lake HX has, we're going to give you 16 efficiency cores. You're getting up to 24 cores, and in a laptop, to get a 40% improvement in multi-core is very nice, I would say. I don't see how anybody could say, oh, it's not a big deal. That is like, that is smoking. In fact, that is actually a higher Cinebench R23 score than the original 32-core Threadripper, the 2990WX, which, of course, when it came out, it was like, oh, my God, right? That was like, holy smokes. So you're actually getting a higher 3D rendering benchmark score in Cinebench. Obviously, there are limitations to using Cinebench as well. But that is a desktop workstation class CPU that this laptop can outperform. So, you know, you gotta give it its props for that. And the next chart, though, I just kind of want to look at is my thread scaling stuff.
All right, right on. Yep.
I like to do that because I think it's kind of fun.
Oh, and we got Elena. 1 second.
Oh, Elena's knocking.
Elena's
knocking. Elena's coming in. Willis is going to let her in. But are you able to get that? Oh, it's showing me on the screen now. This is weird. Is it? Okay. When we get to the point where it's showing you now, Willis. Sorry, we're having.
Yeah.
Oh, hey, we got Dr. Ian Cutress and Tech Potato in the chat. Evening.
All right.
Ian, I was just explaining to the audience your criticisms of Cinebench R23, but we're looking at basically the performance of the 13980HX versus the 12900HX as you go from one thread all the way up to 32 threads. You know, obviously the big gains are on the right side of that chart because you just simply have more cores, even though they are efficiency cores, than the previous 12th gen. But again, you're still getting, you know, 14%, 13%, 10%, 12%, 15%, 17%. Those are actually very decent improvements in performance on that low end, all the very lightly threaded tasks. According to this, this is basically where I take Cinebench. I don't do the full 10-minute run because it would take me days to do it. This is just simply a single run of Cinebench, kind of similar to how Cinebench R20 used to do it. Of course, the scores would be a little higher than what you would see in a 10-minute run because you're not going to throttle down a little bit. But
right.
It's just very nice to get that performance bump across it. Yeah. Ian saying automate it. Yeah, I know. I should automate it, but it takes time to even figure out. I was like, you know what? I've given up. I'm actually going to go ahead and script out some stuff. And another benchmark that I do, I read through the documentation. I started to do this, writing out all the command lines, like then I ran it, and then somehow doing that broke the benchmark. I could no longer run it. So, like not even running it. Period. So it ended up screwing me. I did the rest by hand because it's one of those things where there's never enough time. But you know, I really like this thread scaling one because it just kind of shows you the strength of the CPUs. Generations, because you're only at 12th gen HX versus 13th gen HX, you are getting a very, very decent improvement in performance across the board, I think.
Nice.
Okay. Moving on to historical things, though. So, I mean, obviously, we're only looking at things where I was a little disappointed. A lot of the, I would say a lot of the Pushy Pench stuff, I didn't see the bumps I kind of expected. We'll see. I'm kind of wondering, like, did I screw something up? Because I will tell you, as somebody who doesn't automate, when it's 2 o'clock in the morning, maybe something is wrong. But, you know, these are multiple runs, so I don't think there's something wrong. But I'm going to have to go back in time and or go back, rerun those things, and take another look at them. But I was kind of expecting a little more of a bump. I actually did see it from, you know, the 40 series over the 30 series. But honestly, from the CPU side, it didn't look like it made the improvement that I kind of expected. So we'll see. We will see. But I kind of think, to close out the CPU section, we're going to talk about the historical stuff, right? So can we do the, why don't we do the historical one? The single thread. We'll start off with single threaded again.
Single thread again, okay.
Also, hi everybody.
Hey,
Elena. Oh, and Elena's here.
I'm late.
Yay. Join
you
the
got
party.
Something in, what's the chip behind you? The board.
I don't know.
Oh, okay. So Elena's here for audio listeners, and behind her she has some kind of a circuit board from something. I don't know what it is. Some kind of.
Yeah, I wanted to not make everyone hungry this week.
Oh, I see.
It was appropriate
we didn't
to
eat yet,
have
either.
Something more tech, actual tech themed as my Zoom background right now.
So, so this I do want to show this historical increase. This is kind of fun.
I like these two charts.
This is again Cinebench R23, and I'm not showing another Cinebench result because I only run Cinebench. Please go look at the other videos for the many, many other tests I ran. But again, it's something that everybody's familiar with, so it does at least give you a point of reference to help you understand where we are. I kind of went back, it's like, God, you know what? I want to see what R23 performance is on the top end CPUs from Intel from 7th gen all the way up to 13th gen. So I went back and I grabbed the scores that I had generated, and then I had to go out and look for results from, you know, various other outlets like Notebook Check, a couple others that just actually had reported scores for R23 for those older CPUs. A lot of people don't run R23 on those older ones because, you know, typically you have an old test unit, you run the tests, it goes back to the vendor, you can't run it anymore. So the benchmark literally didn't exist. So you don't have a score, but luckily some of these other outlets had published scores I'm going to rely on. Generally doesn't change. And also I would think most of these other laptops are going to be pretty big because you don't put a top end laptop CPU into, you know, like a 4 pound laptop. So you're looking at the performance from 7th gen all the way up to 13th gen Cinebench R23 single threaded. And again, single threaded is very difficult to get more performance out of. I mean, the vendors have said so themselves. And looking at it from gen to gen, you actually got, you know, basically actually going from 7th to 8th, maybe about 20%, actually pretty decent. And then generally, you know, 10%. We actually saw a very big jump going from, let me make sure I didn't screw up my Excel chart here, D7. Oh, wait, maybe I do have it backwards.
Yep. Do you?
I may have it backwards here. That's the problem of too many Excel charts to juggle. No, not in the what we're showing, but I was going to like do a quick calculation in Excel. I did it earlier. I screwed that up. But you see a nice progression in performance. But, you know, I mean, you're looking at double the single-threaded performance going from 7th generation up to 13th gen. So every new generation, not necessarily new process, not necessarily new MA. But they're still able to eke out a little bit more. And you can see sort of like those leaner years, 7th, 8th, 10th, 7th, 8th, 9th. It was like, you know, they're all Skylake MA. It really didn't really get that much. You know,
I was going to insert though real quick that those also the years that we weren't seeing as much competition from the other side.
Yeah, no, I would agree that, well, although KB's when Ryzen came out, but the AMD did not play in laptops back then. It would take a few more years for them
to do that. Yeah, it took a little bit longer.
But, you know, this is single-threaded performance, though. So single-threaded performance is very, very hard to eke out more. But let's do the next one.
Okay. Next one is fun.
The next one is kind of like, I think...
the multi-thread?
Yeah, we're going to do multi-threaded historical.
Yep, got it.
So on this chart, you're seeing like where you really get the how far we've really come. Looking at the original 7th gen, which was a, you know, a Core i7-7820HK. I remember looking at laptops with that. It was like back then, it was like, okay, this is the best you could get in a laptop. 4011 was a recorded score from someone, another outlet on that chip. We are now pushing 30,000 in 13th gen. And look at that. You went from 4,000 to 7,000 to 8,700 to 11,600 to almost 14,000 with 11th gen. And that was, and then of course, 12th gen is where we saw that big boost, because that's when Intel introduced its hybrid design with, you know, P cores and E cores. And then we go from 13,800 roughly from the 11980HK. Those are my own scores, by the way, to 21,627 for 12th gen. And now we're up at 30,000. So.
I mean, like almost, eightfold? I'm not sure if I'm using the word right. It's eight times almost the amount of the 7th gen score right there.
So, yeah. And, you know, I do think you bring up a really good point, Elena, that the competition, I remember when everybody rightly beat up Intel because it felt like we hit that wall at four cores, right? We had quad core after quad core after quad core. I didn't go back to, yeah. I couldn't find 6th gen or 5th, but they were... Right.
Was like a luxury, right? Like on Thin and Lights, we were stuck on dual core, and yeah. I was like, yay. And then on, you know, here we're looking at what, as you said, quad core. And then we were like, okay, now we got more cores, now we got more threads, still steady progression. I actually put this in my, you know, write up for the website of your data. It was like even just two gens ago, we were still saying to people, hey, like, you know, if you want to save some money, you can still consider previous gen. You're not going to get the same amount of performance as this gen, but the delta isn't so large that it's not worth the cost savings. And now you look at this, you're just like, man, I don't know if I'd want to go last gen, given how much more performance I get with 13 over 12 or back even last gen 12 over 11. Right. Like it's just it just went like nitro fueled.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's just crazy to see. It's taken off like a rocket because, you know, there is competition now. Intel,
exactly.
They got Air, everybody, they're looking over their shoulder at Apple. They're looking over their shoulder at AMD. So,
yep.
And you can't, you know, I think that a lot of the criticism was valid when they were just kind of like stuck. And I do think it's a little unfair because Intel did try pushing more cores with the AGTC back then. And most people never bought it. You could argue, AMD would say like this because you couldn't sell at the price we could, but either way, they did at least try to push multi-core, get 6 cores and 8 cores and higher end desktop that nobody bought. I would say the situation on laptop weren't so slow to react on laptop. If you actually looked at desktop, it feels like they were very much slower, but laptop, you could see clearly we're like, you know, 7th gen on, we're gonna get on the gas. So I think you have to give it, the reason I think this is valuable is you have to give it to Intel because 13th gen is a significant increase in performance over 12th gen, which itself was a significant increase in performance over 11th gen. So they just keep ladling on the cores that everybody wants, and it's nice. So you got to give that to them. So I just want to point that out.
I would say just to add on to that, I mean, the two charts ago, when we were looking at the thread scaling, I think it's also important to note that it's not just that they threw more cores at it, it's that they also are getting a lot of performance out of each of those cores. Because sometimes we look at those thread scaling, some of those thread scaling charts you do, and you'll see it like, it's not like an even kind of amount, right? Sometimes it's like, oh, on the like, these threads here kind of dips a little bit, then it goes back up. And then once you get to the the almost full load on all cores, then it really takes off, right? But this, I mean, you're getting pretty healthy gains, except for maybe like what, three thread use right there?
Yeah.
You know, everything's, you know, in the teens, and then you start going very steadily into the 20s, and then bam, like you hit the 30s when you go to an full load workload right there. And I actually found that just more impressive to me than some of the other charts that I saw. I mean, don't get me wrong. Just saying a little benchmark fatigue here, but just given the fact that we have seen more like peaks and valleys on this particular chart, I think that kind of proves your point too, where they're not going just for a particular selling point. They're truly going for, hey, laptops are huge for them.
Yeah.
So they really want to defend that territory.
Yeah. And part of what, gives it that advantage, because 13th gen to 12th gen was like more cores is the story, but they are also, as you saw on desktop, they are just simply pushing everything really hard, right? And it's kind of the approach with the last couple laptop CPUs is like, we're just going to go for it. And I doing power testing, battery and all that takes immensely more work. That's still to come, but I can tell you, yeah, it's gonna suck the juice down. But in a gaming, I think in a desktop gaming laptop like this, you know what? It's just like you have a maximum of 100 watt hour battery. Otherwise, you can't bring it on a plane. That's never gonna change. So I don't think it's ever gonna get great for anything. So I like what Intel's done with the HX, because it said, you know what? You're not gonna play games unplugged from the wall for 6 hours. And if you're really expecting that, you're not going to get that from anything, anybody. I don't care what, you're not going to get 6 hours of real gaming at high performance. If you really want to push everything really hard, it's just not going to, because you have a gas tank of 100 hours. So they basically said, we don't care. We know Apple's there. We know AMD's efficiency is great too. We don't care. Because we're just going to get on the gas. We want to cross the finish line first. So
we talked about this on previous shows. When it came to the desktop parts, that the word efficiency is kind of a flexible term, right? In the sense that it can be efficient in the sense that it's low power consumption, or this particular generation across the board, it's efficient in the sense that it does a lot with what it has. So even though it's drawing a lot, it is also outputting a lot.
Yeah. You do have to look at that perspective too. I think that's, but so again, what'd you think? So you got to basically, suffer the pain of going through all the damn results. What was your impression, Elena? Were you impressed, not impressed? See, we're only talking CPU side. We're going to talk about GPU side soon.
Yeah, I was just about to say, I was like, okay. So, obviously, I did not go through the amount of torture, self-torture, I don't know what you want to call it, the marathon, the long endurance ultra marathon of generating all these benchmarks. I got to come in towards the end, and you passed the baton for, a separate part of the route. And then I, took a look at it and wrote up a more succinct, concise summary for our website. And I actually kind of thought, like, and this sounds bad, so stick with me for a second here. I was writing this and I was like, gosh, I'm not as excited about this as I feel like I should be. Because at this point, and it's nobody's fault, right? Like, if you actually look at the numbers, it is very exciting. But I think at this point, it's almost like, how you get like novelty fatigue, right? Like, these companies have been making such impressive like gains with the CPU side of things, whether it's laptop or desktop, that at this point it's like, well, what's the story I'm really telling here? Like, people are going to start to come to expect this, because we're kind of a spoiled group here at this point, right? And so I think it's a really great outcome for people like Adam and Willis, who, when they go to trade shows and they need to, start getting those videos up from CES, Computex, whatever show we happen to be at, it's going to make their jobs a lot easier. But I think for a lot of people who are more like me, who don't really need this much power, it's like, oh, that's super cool. It's like when you see a McLaren or you see, any kind of really fancy, shiny car, you're like, oh, that's super right. cool. And then you go back to, in my case, my Toyota beater car. You're like, well, this is what I'm going home in. Toot, toot. Beep, beep. So for me, the actual more exciting story is on the GPU side, because I think that's a little more relatable as more of a, in this context, a mainstream user. But again, still very impressive numbers. Very cool to see, like, just how, in terms of like sports teams, like watching somebody just, make monumental gains, like whether that's in, sports or this or anything, it's always cool to see something or someone just go bam, just like that huge leap into the next,
Arena. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm also excited to, use it on a editing laptop because then, you know, like Elaine said, I'm going to trade shows. And I brought a, was it the Acer D, Concept D7, and that was a 10th gen, I think. And it was just so, it was, we're editing 4K videos with, you know, with you guys, and it just didn't feel snappy. So I'm like, with 13th gen, that significant performance of just, you know, playback and, you know, even export and would be very helpful in that case.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think, you know, because it's interesting, because most you all three of you are actually editing videos back in your hotel rooms.
Yeah.
You bring it. I mean, there's a use case scenario for bringing a big ass laptop like this, right? Yeah. Because you set it up. This thing has a 4K mini LED screen in it. You set that up. You basically don't. You could bring a small form factor box and monitors, but then that basically means that's a significant more amount of crap you've got to pack too. So there, I'd be interested to see how this does against a small form factor. I think it might reasonably. It probably. I think it'll do reasonably well against a small form factor because, again, looking at some of the Puget Bench results, I mean, they're good, but I mean, I kind of expected a bigger uplift here. So, but I do think, like, getting back to your topic, I think it's like a expectation management is what I would call it. Like, these companies very much have to manage expectations of, you know, the press. They have to manage expectations of the public, and when the expectations outpace what's coming, it actually, you get backlash, right? Like, you're right. Like, it felt like, you know, I guess it's okay. Like 14, like Adam was same thing. He was like, I didn't think single threaded was like a big deal. Like, a 14% is like, that's pretty good, right?
Remember the old days? It'd be like, yeah, 15%, really solid. Like, yeah, happy to see this.
That would be everything, like, though. Yeah.
Now it's like, is it 30? Okay, yeah, like that's kind of what I was like, you know.
Yeah, I mean that. I mean, I think that's kind of the world we're in because they are just killing themselves trying to improve to because they want to be better than the competition. Everybody, AMD, Apple, and Intel. You know, like arguably, like I would say, like the reception here is like, oh, okay, yeah, it's good. It's 40%. You know, I'd say that's impressive, but that's. You know, I expect that 40% improvement. And like, look at that. I looked at a lot of the coverage on the Apple side with the M2 launch. It was like, well, you know, the usual stuff. It's like, well, you know, this is like, it's okay. It's just a generational bump. It's like, because they were like, they're expecting that kind of like kick you in the ass kind of improvement that they saw because like M1 and the M1 Pro and Max were like impressive, right? And the original, they were like kicking you in the ass kind of like M1, M2 was like, yeah, you know, I guess it's a little better, right? But then, you know, a lot of us, it was very much, you know, as you can expect, there were definitely some, there were stories like justifying it. Well, it's, you know, it's really not a big deal, right? Because you got to wait for the next thing, you know, they kind of like explaining it away. But I do feel that there was some, definitely a letdown by on that side of the aisle where there were people like, what's up with this? Like, how's this? Is the M2 really an M2? You could like this if the Mac press covered the Mac the way the PC press did, you'd be like, how is this an M2? This is like an M1A. Like, I ain't getting jack from this. And like maybe M1X. Like maybe I mean, like, this is it. I get like what, 20% or 15%? Single threaded performance is like dead, like 10%, and multi, and like, you know, like. They were just, you know, it's just not as harsh, you know, I feel like, so.
Yeah.
And I think that's just part of the management because, like, I believe me, you get people overly hyped based on leaks on what we expect out of V-cache versions. And it's bad, right? Because you have everybody like, oh, my God, the new one's going to be 50% faster. It's only 30% faster than people, like, then they flip out because it's not what their expectations were, right?
Yeah. I think, I mean, that's definitely... And that is unfortunately what the human brain tends to do. For me, I don't think I went that far. I think it was just more of a, oh, okay. Like, we saw this on desktop, right? And honestly, that in of itself is, I think, impressive because I feel like if we go back in time, like how, you know, let's say like 2KB Lake or even Coffee Lake, in that era, we weren't really looking for analogous type of jumps between the two different types of chips, you know? And now it's like, oh, Raptor Lake. Yeah, this seems about right, given what we saw on desktop. And it's just like, well, today's Monday. And that's not really fair, again, to the teams that put, you know, so much work into this. But I think it's just that we're getting conditioned to expect it, which is maybe creating a little bit of monster in all of us.
Yeah, but I do think it's hopefully good, you know, because I think, you know, Intel, there's like the leak stories are saying, you know, Meteor Lake or whatever the next one is going to be is Lunar. I can't remember the code names, but, you know, should bring some significant increases in performance too. So we expect great things because honestly, they have to, right? If like definitely going back from, you know, fourth to fifth to sixth gen to seventh gen, oh, 6%, 7%, like those single digit gains everywhere. That definitely does not is not going to fly anymore. So you got to at least it's got to, but you know, again, so like I would say looking at it historically, 13 gen is like it does track where you expect it. Like I would say I'm pleased. It's everywhere I expect it to be, right? So that's a good thing.
I mean, it's a win across the board for people who need this kind of power
Right.
and performance. Like, my reaction probably would be a little less subdued if I hadn't wrecked my own sleep cycle last night.
Oh.
But in general, yeah, I think that again, we heard it right from the type of people who need this sort of performance. Like Willis was literally just talking about how it works for him and his needs. So it's good that we have this kind of option. I'm more interested, and I don't know if it's time to do the turnover of topics.
I think we should.
I'm actually more interested in seeing what you think about the mobile 4090.
Oh, yeah. No, let's. Can we go to the? We'll flip the topic. Hit the spinner thing, whatever
All
that is.
right, all right. And
Should we do the charts first, and then we can get into discussion?
then
yeah, which one do you want to start?
Why don't we do the Blender benchmark?
Blender? All right. Here.
Yeah.
And okay.
I gotta. So in the same laptop, by the way, besides the fact that you have 13 gen in there, we have the GeForce RTX 4090 laptop GPU. I know for some of you feel better. The RTX 4090 M. Now you feel better now about that. This first result is a Blender open benchmark. It basically is actually it's kind of nice because I used to run everything by hand using Blender, and it's kind of a pain in the butt. This is nice. You can download this benchmark for free. It will try to publish your scores, by the way, if you care or not care. Does Monster GPU, Junk Shop GPU, as well as Classroom GPU. You can run this on the CPU or you can run it on the CPU. There isn't one thing I do want to warn you about. It doesn't really tell you what it's testing. Is it optics? Is it CUDA? So it makes me a little uncomfortable. I actually used to try to run it by hand on our, you know, our, on optics or CUDA or whatever, but this is definitely an easy way to do it. And it produces samples per second, and more is better, by the way, bigger bar better. The light green is the previous top-end GeForce RTX 3080 Ti laptop GPU at 175 watt TGP. In basically the same chassis. This, of course, is the RTX 4090 laptop GPU, and you're looking at 131% improvement in the Monster samples per minute, 66% improvement in Junk Shop, and 98% improvement in the classroom tests. So, wow, right? That's a big jump. That is a big jump. This, of course, is rendering basically on the RTX 4090 laptop GPU versus the 3080 Ti laptop GPU.
So, as somebody who does not use Blender, looking at it from this perspective, where bigger bar is better, like what is this measuring exactly versus, say, like when we use Blender to, because you also did another benchmark. I
Oh.
don't think you have the chart for it here, but when you're measuring it, was a barbershop for time, how long it takes. So, like, what's really the difference between looking at it from the two different perspectives?
The first perspective would be, why the F are you rendering this on your CPU? Just like, because you're looking at a significant increase, and you see this with a lot of different tasks when you're throwing it at these big ass GPUs. When I do a CPU render by hand on, you know, Blender, you're like, you just come back, like you start it, I go upstairs, you come back in an hour, like, okay, it's done now, right? You're running on the GPU, you just start it, you're like, you browse the web for a little bit, okay, it's done. It's significantly faster on a GPU than a CPU, and a 3080 it's so hard, I keep forgetting it to give it its TI. The 3080 Ti laptop GPU, if you were to render the scene, might take an hour. If you do it on a 4090, half an hour, right? So that's...
Sorry, I actually meant the difference between the two Blender benchmarks for the GPU.
Oh, here. They're just different models. Why are they different? You know, what's interesting is this is the classic thing where you think, like, again, Cinebench R23 is seen as like, oh, well, this is like the be-all, end-all. That's just one scene doing one thing. I bet if you took Blender, if you took Cinema 4D and you did something else, it might be faster on AMD. Might be faster on Apple, might be faster on Intel, might be faster on NVIDIA GPU, there's different things that you're doing because the model is different, the textures on it, there's just so many different things. And we see this same problem with trying to judge Premiere performance or Photoshop or anything. It really takes you take a different journey through this gigantic, you know, 1 gigabyte application, and the results can be very different. It's just like being in a game where you're indoors and you're getting 800 frames a second. You're outdoors and you're getting, you know, 400 frames a second. So it's just very, I will say early on, there was a CPU vendor that said, oh yeah, you should check out this benchmark. You know, they pass on this model. I ran it on the CPU vendor's CPU. It's like, oh, it's actually very fast. And on Ryzen, actually, it's actually a little bit faster on this one than the competitor's CPU. That doesn't make any sense, right? Why is that? And actually, that particular model, for some reason, just didn't use as many threads as the other model, that like the popular like BMW at the time, right? So there's just definitely different workloads that stress different things.
Got it.
But this is one uniform benchmark. So this is basically created. It's created by the folks who do Blender, so it's basically a standardized benchmark. So is that result going to be what you get? Maybe not, but so probably is kind of like probably the long answer.
So basically these different sub benchmarks, I don't know if you would call them, are just
different models.
So like gives you a better sense that if your workload matches them, you get a better sense of what kind of performance uptake or uplift you're looking at.
Yeah. And actually, then let me answer a question. Ian asks, from Dr. Ian Kittress, by the way, go over there, like and subscribe and smash that bell button somewhere down there. Did the GT77 have one 330 watt power supply or two? One single. We haven't really talked about power yet, but only a single 330 watt power supply. So yeah, no, it really is. It's just a different model. And it does make me a little squiffy because I don't know what it does. Like when I load Barbershop and I run it on Optix or I run it on CUDA or I run it on the CPU, I know how I ran it, right? This doesn't really tell you how it runs it. So it's a little, but you know, again, it's nice because it's available on Mac, it's available on PC, it's easy to run. So
So this was my long way of trying to figure out if I should just insert another piece of information into this discussion, and I will. For people who are used to seeing Barbershop results and think of Blender in terms of how much faster it is, or maybe improvement in speed. So I think it was about 30% that you saw improvement in speed, right? That's what I remember looking at in the chart and what I used.
I don't even think it tells. So the other thing is like when I take like Barbershop and I'd, you know, you do hand runs of it, you know, it would take, say, an hour on the CPU, right? Mm. Even if you did it on the GPU, it might take, you know, 10 minutes, 5 minutes, 10 minutes.
I'm just going by your own data.
I can't remember.
It's in your chart.
Oh, that's good. Oh, you mean the one that's in there now? Yeah. So because I did run it. I did run it by hand as well, but I.
Yeah.
So the reason why Blender is like.
Did a lot of numbers.
Because there's a certain point where you're like, you know what? It is. I just want to go to sleep. And the Blender benchmark is great because I can run this within 6 minutes. I know what the results are, right? The like you're doing multiple 10-minute GPU runs. You know, that's it just comes down to time. Like, and then you have to, like, if you're doing multiple CPU runs, next thing you know, it's 4 o'clock in the morning. So that's why it's kind of nice, because at least it's a data point that, you know, is out there. So yeah, and as somebody pointed out, the Blender results only apply to Blender. Yeah, and it's very true, because it may not be a direct translation. Although generally, when you're looking at, you know, 60%, you know, we saw Cinebench was about 40%. You know, it may or may not, depending on what you're doing, your 3D rendering task may. At least you know generally multi-core, the 24 core is going to outperform a 16 core, right? That's at least we know that. And we're seeing the validations of that in the Blender benchmark. Now, everything we've talked about Blender. People want to know about Blender, the other stuff. So let's do Geekbench.
All right.
I don't know if Geekbench is exactly what the people were expecting to move to from Blender.
I know. I just did it. You know, I can't even find it here.
Yeah. Well, okay. Yeah, I have that up. But before you go on, Gordon, so we do have a super chat from our friend of the show, Eek44, with 89 Danish crones. Thank you so much. It's like, nice done, Gordon. But 3080 Ti against 4090. And it was only because you have the laptops available to you, right?
I'm sorry, the question is why?
But why?
You mean why only, like, two?
Why those two?
I think it's more of a question, like, it doesn't seem fair to pit the 3080 Ti against a 4090.
Oh, I see. But, you know, remember laptops, you don't like, oh, by the way, can I go in and buy this laptop with this GPU and the CPU? Mm-hmm. You know, you get a whole package, and generally they design, like, you buy an i5, you're not getting a 4090. That's just not, you want the leather seats, but you don't want the sunroof. They don't do that way. It's usually stuff is combined. I think it's the reason why I did it is, one, they were like for like, because we're talking about basically a 7-pound laptop versus a 7-pound laptop. They both also run on 330-watt power supplies. And it's basically the same chassis, although the cooling arrangement for the heat pipes is a little different on the 13th gen 4090 laptop than it is on the older version. I also wanted fresh benchmarks. So one of the problems is, if you do a test on a laptop, it goes back to the vendor and I can't run Windows 11, you know, 22H2, right? So these are all fresh benchmarks. You know, new drivers, new everything. So I can actually control the test myself. I could, you know, I will say I had another laptop, but it was a 16-inch laptop, had a 4090 in it. I decided, due to some issues I had, I also couldn't include it. But it also would have felt weird, too, because, like, you're talking about a 16-inch laptop that's, you know, 5 pounds versus, yeah, you know, a 7-pound laptop. Right. So this is very much... You're getting a view for the previous fastest NVIDIA GPU against the current fastest NVIDIA laptop GPU. So, and I know, of course, people are like, why didn't you include any Ryzen? Unfortunately, I don't have any HX 6000 numbers that I could even reference, because I don't think I ever tested a HX 6000 laptop. And I also think if I'd gone to like a 5000 HX, it would just kind of look, it wouldn't look right, because now you're looking at an older laptop and you're also looking at an 8-core HX from AMD, which arguably is the best. Intel would say that's the best they got, and that's the best they got, right? And, you know, you're going up against a 24-core 13th-gen chip with a 4090 in it, and it's just going to get blown off the field, and rightly so, right? So I just felt like, let's concentrate, do more tests on two to give you a feel for 13th-gen with 4090, versus 12th gen with 3080 Ti. So that was my rationale for you, because you have to pick a choice. I'm sure there are other reviewers out there that have tried to look at other laptops to try to compare, but I kind of wanted to do a deeper dive on to, you know, very similar chassis, because that does make a difference. You take a 4090 laptop GPU and you put it into a, you know, an Asus ROG G14, at 75 or 100 watts, it may not perform as well as this MSI, I'm going to guess. So,
right. Yeah, it's typical. You have to kind of, it ends up scaling based on, you know, what the chassis can support.
Yeah. So, yeah, I know, Geekbench. I'm just mentioning Geekbench because this is another, I just want to get this out there. This is basically using Geekbench. It has some built-in compute. Yeah, I know Ian is rolling his eyes right now. But, you know, again, so we see the performance of the RTX 3080 Ti laptop versus the RTX 4090 laptop in compute. And what are we looking at here? 53% in CUDA and 50% basically in OpenCL performance. And I just wanted to mention that, you know, 225,000 versus 150,000 in OpenCL. And I just want to, I want to mention this here because I mentioned in the other video, apparently it triggers the Mac people. The M2 Max, the best score I think I saw was like 75,000 in OpenCL. So, you know, hey, it is what it is. This next one I just want to show. And the reason is, I ran this stupid test and then I forgot to mention it. Can you pull up the Topaz one?
Topaz one, all right.
Oh my God.
You did a lot of testing.
Yeah, because I mean, that's okay. The nice thing is when you decide to reduce the test set, then you can do more testing. So this is, I actually did Topaz testing with mobile laptops or laptops two and a half years ago. I kind of stopped doing it because the folks at Topaz Labs, they do great work, but they never, ever stop. Like I ran, so this is Topaz, I didn't write down there, Topaz Video AI, right?
Yeah, you did.
So, yes, what you have on there.
So it's essentially an AI-based upscaling for video. You can feed it your crappy old videos and then you can magically get 1080p and 4K that's cleaned up and looks really nice. I've done that to some wedding videos. This video was just basically a 720p video that I upscaled to 1080p because I didn't want to take, you know, 5 hours to do it multiple times at 4K using AI to upscale it on the GPU. And looking at the RTX 4090 laptop versus the 3080 laptop, Ti laptop, look, again, 50% improvement. Well, 47.5, I guess, if you want to be technical about it, but that's almost a 50% improvement in the time it took to do this upscaling. Let me finish my story about Topaz. One of the problems with Topaz is, like, I started to use the version 3.31 on Tuesday. The next morning I woke up, they came out with 3.32. So I locked down the version. It's fine. There's probably no major change. But I can tell you within a month, they'll be so far removed. It's hard, unless I use the old version of it that's now out of date by 3 months and is maybe a full version behind it, then it's less useful. But looking at this AI upscaling, and it is very impressive. Lynn Alinus has done video on it. Joel at Extreme Tech has used it to upscale DS9. It's really cool stuff. But you're getting a nearly 50% improvement in the AI upscaling on the 40 series versus the 30 series here. So pretty damn impressive. And I just wanted to mention that because I forgot to put this one benchmark chart in the video because I was too tired and forgot to. So got to do it.
Peace.
Where are we going next?
Did you do some? You did some.
Let's
gaming.
Do some gaming. Yeah. So we're at the end. We're almost at the end here. Sorry, we'll do 3D Mark. Let's do 3D Mark first.
3D Mark. All right.
I'm just gonna put that up there because I think it's every. But again, you know, it's 3D Mark made by UL. It's a synthetic benchmark. The reason why it's used by overclockers is because it's extremely reliable to run. It is, you know, purely a GPU benchmark in some circumstances. So it gives you a really good feel. We're removing the CPU overall here because 12th gen to 13th gen does make somewhat of a difference. I'm not even really paying attention here to the CPU stuff, but look, what are we looking at? Time Spy graphics. So we're only going to do graphics. Time Spy graphics, 64% improvement from 30 series to 40 series. Port Royal, 65%. And then looking at Speedway, 70% improvement, if I'm looking at this right. Yeah, 70%, right? That's a big deal. Yes, it is, of course, 3D Mark, but 3D Mark is, of course, synthetic. It is still respected as a very useful metric for people to look at. But let's look at some real games. So let's click on over to... What else I got here? Let's do Quake 2. Quake 2.
All right.
Quake
Again,
2. Yeah.
There's a ton more benchmarks in the GPU video we have. There's tons more in the CPU video we have. Let's look at 2019, Quake 2 2019 RTX. It's a fully path traced version of Quake 2. It's pretty cool if you actually played the original version because now you're playing it fully path traced. I run it at 4K. I'm also running at 1440p. You could see it's actually, you know, at you know, 49% or 49 frames per second at 4K on the 4090 laptop GPU. It's actually very playable. Yeah, it'd be nicer if you had a little more, but you were only getting about 30 frames a second on that 3080 Ti laptop GPU. So I would say big win. And let's look at the actual. That is, you know, again, I mean, this number just came up over and over and over again. That's 65%. 65.7, 66% at 4K improvement, 62% at 1440p, and there you're pushing 108 frames a second, and of course there's no DLSS magic stuff here, so that's just raw performance in a fully path-traced game on this. It's just pretty nutty, so I think it's just impressive, because like almost all the games, you were looking at 60 to 70%, improvement, like a lot of them are just like they were just 60%, 70% that you were just seeing it almost across the board at 4K. You know, the NVIDIA's 50. Go ahead.
I was gonna say, like, yeah, like the numbers are like 50%, 60% range, one hit 70% range, but some of these also incorporate DLSS, right? So
yeah.
That's something that we'll get to in a moment as well.
Yeah, and people do want to see DLSS, and luckily the day after we started testing Cyberpunk 2077, patch came out that supported the DLSS 3. So you're looking at the results for Cyberpunk 2077 with ray tracing set to Psycho. DLSS is set to balanced, and the top result, which is light green, is the 3080 Ti laptop GPU. The slightly darker green in the middle is the 4090 laptop GPU. That's with DLSS 2 versus DLSS on as well. But I did not have frame generation on for that. Frame generation, which is somewhat controversial for some, is turned on with the darker bar, right? So that is that dark green bar is where frame generation is on. And we go from 48 frames a second to basically 90 frames a second. So with the frame generation and DLSS set to balance, you're looking at 3080 Ti laptop. Again, that was in NVIDIA's previous fastest laptop GPU. You're now pushing 90 frames a second at 4K.
Sorry, Willis, for some reason, I don't think the slide actually made the transition.
Right.
Could you
try
again?
Yep.
Oh, we're going to do it again. Willis is going to show this to the YouTube crowd. So sorry, I don't have that up, the stream up. It's being updated now. So now you're seeing it. So again, that dark green is with frame generation on. The medium green in the middle is with frame generation off. Whatever you think of it, I will say I'm impressed. I mean, look, if you go to 1440p, you're going from, 60 frames a second, pretty decent for that 3080 Ti laptop GPU versus 85 frames a second. Again, nice improvement for 4090 laptop, but you turn on frame generation, you're pushing 139 frames a second. So it's nice. Now, of course, some people would say like, oh, well, frame generation's, fake frames, and that just gets you into the whole philosophical discussion. Then it gets into the mosh pit of arguing about, is this really a 4090? I don't know if we want to go there or not, but I do want to show
not
you.
Not just yet.
Not just yet. Elena, just what yet. Are your thoughts? What are your thoughts on this?
I would just say that regardless of where you stand on this point, right, with that discussion that we're tabling for the moment, even if you just look at the increase in performance with DLSS on, right? So DLSS 2, you're still getting a 57% increase in performance at 4K, which is tangible, very tangible, right? You're going from, you know, by most today's standards, barely playable 30 frames per second to a smoother 48, almost 50 frames per second, which, you know, I think everyone can agree is a very tangible improvement.
Right.
And then you get the added bonus, and how you feel about that is, you know, your based on your own, you know, feelings about it. But then that's like a 200% increase. I think it's like 195% increase when I did the math. It's nuts. Like, this, say what you will about the technology, the fact that it can even do that is impressive.
Yeah.
You don't have to like it, but at least acknowledge that it's pretty cool tech.
Right, right. And there's definitely, we're still in the early days of the frame generation too. I expect it to even get better, but I don't think NVIDIA is going to back off of this. This is the path forward for them, right? Because they just, you know, they've sort of said this, like, you can't brute force this. So AI is just going to play a big part of how we go forward. And, you know, it really gets down to what is, because a lot of people, for people who don't know, listen, I will back it up and say frame generation with DLSS 3 basically creates frames. So the GPU renders a frame, and then it also looks at that frame that was created, and it basically creates an AI version of it that, of course, is a little different because it knows what's going on. And a lot of people have been screaming, well, that's not real because that's not actually rendered out. And, you know, then it gets into, I really do think, like, what is a frame? Like, I don't want to get too crazy, but, like, if you think about it, your GPU renders out a line in a game, and then it goes in and does anti-aliasing. It basically fills in those little jaggies. Are those fake pixels? Because it's those, you know, I mean, it really kind of, I mean, and also let's remember, folks, the graphics card does some math, special math, way beyond me that I can understand, creates a frame. Now the AI takes even more special fancy math and creates another one. Why isn't the first frame fake? Isn't it all really fake? I mean, let's not get too existential about this, but what is real? Especially when you're playing a fake game, right? You're not playing, like, you're not like, this is not a view into reality. You're not like going through your screen, running through the world. You're just simply playing rendered made up games based on math.
I feel like that's the epitome of the AI discussion in general. Like, what is real? What is not? Like, chicken or the egg? Who comes first? However, I think the more valid point here is the idea of latency. But this is starting to open up that can of worms that we were trying to avoid in terms of topics we wanted to cover while it's going over the benchmarks.
I can bring us back to Dr. Ian Cutress mentions, how much of your life do you want without ray tracing? /S, meaning he's just kidding. They're referencing a 2018 internet kind of meme. I will say, though, it really does kind of make me think. And this brings up, we were talking about karaoke earlier. Kind of think you like this. If you take that, what Ian just said, how much of your life do you want without ray tracing? If you could sing that song, but with the Aerosmith song, I don't want to miss a minute.
Yeah. Like, I don't miss a thing. Yeah.
I think I would karaoke that, because you don't, I don't want to miss. You would not want to hear me sing, but you would like.
Oh, well, we do.
But it'd be about ray tracing. So, like, parody. I've always wanted to do like a, there needs to be some parodies, but you have to have someone who can sing. Otherwise, you shouldn't do it, because it's an offense to humanity and gamers. But could you see, how much of your life do you want to miss without ray tracing, but set to Aerosmith's song? Does the Weird Al law get us around that? Can we do it as parody without getting sued?
But I feel like we're really in the weeds or off tracks right
now. We're off tracks. I just wanted to mention that, because it's just funny. But yeah, no, I again. this is a controversy we are not going to settle here today. And I do want to point that out, though. What is real? What is not? Because I know people, they just want to trash it by saying fake frames. I think.
So,
you know.
Okay. I know I said that we're getting off the rails here, but I would say that there is an argument to be made for saying there's a difference between the original generation, you know, versus a derivative of that. And you could argue a fine, there's a line between those two, right? Because you have one that's created by directly just, you know, talking, quote unquote, to the game, right? And then what the GPU is doing is going, oh, okay, well, based off of that, I'm going to create this. So if it's even that 1 degree removed, for, I guess maybe for some people, it's no longer original Coke, it is new Coke.
I guess, I don't know. I mean, I don't know. It's just way too deep for me. I just think.
This is a conversation that you and Ian should have, I feel.
Well,
like.
Is it, I mean, what's real, what's not real, right? Because that's, but, okay. But should we do the next one, though?
Yeah.
This is the last one. We're into the last one, because you can't avoid it. You can't avoid it.
There's so many more benchmarks too in your video.
Yeah,
so
there's
if
more.
If you want to see the full lineup, definitely check out Gordon's coverage in the separate video on the PC World channel.
Yes. All right.
Oh, dude, there's somebody in chat mentioning Crystal Pepsi. That brings back memories.
Is it a TGB reduction?
This is basically, I was going to call it the color stripe gum chart. Okay. Is it the
color stripe gum
chart? Does anybody remember what that is? Do they even make that anymore? For people who don't know, or they basically, like, if RGB was in your first gaming computer, you would not know what it is. Color stripe game gum is a gum that comes in different colors. And there's a zebra that was the front animal for it.
Yes.
Oh my gosh, this is like, I feel like I remember this maybe.
Like mid-90s, early 90s.
Yeah, see, with Adam here, or Brad, we go off the rails all the time. But what you are looking at, internet, and sorry, audio listeners, on the screen we have basically bars, because that's the only like shape the internet understands. The GeForce desktop GPU versus laptop GPU, looking at core... published bandwidth numbers. I actually had to, I got lazy eventually because NVIDIA doesn't publish them all. I had to go look them up on, I think I sold this, I can't remember their name. Sorry, they have that massive, the GPU database. I really have to give them the shout out for this.
Oh, I'm blanking.
My brain is blanking. They, awesome site. But anyway, looking at bandwidth as well as the reduction in TGP, the rated TGP between the desktop part. So we're talking full-on desktop part as well as the laptop part. And this is from the 6 series, 680 versus 680M, 780 versus 780M, 980 versus 980M, 1080 versus 1080M. And actually, when we got to... You will see, so if you're looking at this chart, you see the reduction, green bar is the reduction in the actual CUDA cores between the desktop and laptop version. The, what color is that? Orange? The
yellow?
Orange color, yellow, orange, yellow. The
yellow.
Orange color is the reduction in bandwidth, memory bandwidth, that's the published memory bandwidth, the memory memory type, regardless. Purple is the reduction in TGP. And we see the original 680 desktop versus 680M. You saw about a 13% CUDA core reduction, 40% bandwidth reduction, 49% TGP reduction. For the 70 series, 780 versus GTX 780M, those actually did have M in the model number, 33% reduction. For CUDA cores, 44% reduction in bandwidth, 51% reduction in TGPs. So the TGP reduction is always there. As we got to 980, 980M, 25% for CUDA cores. Bandwidth reduction was 29%, and purple TGP reduction was 26%. And here's actually the important part, because I remember NVIDIA being so proud. They're like, yeah, 980M, that's a reduced part. from the desktop part. And it's a laptop. We're on an older, we're talking years and years ago. 980M, you're not going to be able to get a full on the same part. So we had to reduce the CUDA cores, the memory bandwidth is down, but we are there. We are finally at the day, Gordon, where the desktop part is basically going to be the same as the laptop part. So the GTX 1080 versus GTX 1080M, 0% reduction in CUDA cores, 0% reduction in bandwidth, and yet it is still a laptop. You had a 17% reduction in the rated TGP of those. When we got to the 2080 series versus 2080M, you actually saw the same thing. Basically the same dies between laptop and desktop. So you saw no reduction in CUDA cores, no reduction in bandwidth. We get the 2080 Super. Actually, we're going to do a slight reduction in memory bandwidth. But of course, power, remember, you don't have an 800-watt power supply. You don't have an 850-watt power supply. The best you can get is really 330 watts. There are some power supplies that are larger. They are very, very rare, very, very expensive. There may be some regulatory issues from country to country. The limit is a 330-watt power supply for your entire system, including screen and everything. So the TGP reductions are always big. But as you see, 20 series, we lasted two generations where desktop die was the same as laptop die in the top end. We get to 30 series, and you know what? I don't hear NVIDIA saying, oh, yeah, same thing to same thing anymore. We go to a 29% reduction in CUDA cores from the RTX 3080 to the RTX 3080 laptop, 41% reduction in memory bandwidth, and a 64% reduction in TGP, because clearly they use more power with the 30 series. As you get to RTX 3080 Ti, 28% reduction in CUDA cores, 44% in bandwidth, and TGP is 57%. And now here we are to the day of the 40 series. The 4080 is 4080 desktop versus 4080 laptop. Of course, if we want to get really existential, what is a 4080 desktop GPU? I don't know, but 24% reduction in CUDA cores, 46% reduction in memory bandwidth, and 53% reduction in TGP. And of course, we get the 4090 desktop versus 4090 laptop, 41% reduction in CUDA cores, a 49% reduction in bandwidth, and honestly, that the most here is that TGP reduction. We do see a 67% reduction in power between the mobile and the desktop part. So I will say there were two generations where NVIDIA thought they could use desktop and mobile, and it hasn't been that way in a long, long time, right? And I don't know if we're going to get back there, but it's hard to actually see that ever happening. But I made this entire chart because I just think it's very valuable to point out that laptop GPUs have not been the same. And look at the trend. Most of the time, they are not the same die. And you clearly are not getting the same dies here. It was really only the 1080 and the 2080. I mean, 2080 Super, if you kind of count it, but they were really not a big change in it. Really, there was a short period where it wasn't the trend, but that's the trend is generally laptops are not going to be the same as desktops. So I bring this up because a lot of people say 4090, this 4090 laptop is not the same as a 4090 desktop. So what do you think? What do you think, Lena?
I laughed because I didn't know we were going to have this conversation today. We were going to table it for another day. It's okay. I'm ready for it. I just didn't know we were starting. Stirring that pot.
I just feel you have to because it's just, you're getting 60 to 200% improvement in performance on this thing. And the only first thing you hear is it's not a 4090 desktop, or fake frames. But, I just kind of feel like we have to talk about it.
I mean, so from my perspective, I think there's a lot of valid arguments being made on both sides, if you can really call them sides, so I agree that naming could be so much better when it comes to these different parts, because So we had this conversation on the show, what, 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago? I forget how long ago. It wasn't that long ago that we were talking about this. And basically, I think if you are a person who is into enthusiast hardware, you keep up with the news. Yeah, it's not weird to you that the two are going to be different. Like you just kind of expect it. You've learned the lay of the land, so it seems natural to you, right? But I think there's a very valid and fair argument to make that if you just because you aren't familiar with it doesn't mean that you're supposed to be, for lack of a better term, a victim of your own ignorance, right? Like, it's not fair to say that someone who's like first getting started in content creation or like finally able to buy their own hardware, high-end hardware, like they should be able to make an they should be able to have an easier time of comparing, like, do I want a desktop setup for this, or do I want to have the option of being able to travel with my setup, right? And not have to really dig deep and say, oh, wait a second, these two things that are labeled the same are not actually the same thing. Like, I think that is unfair to people like that. And I think there are more of those types of people than maybe the enthusiast crowd makes allowances for. Like, probably not as much as like me making this argument may like that may make this may make it sound like, but I think that's a non-zero, and I think it's non-zero enough that it's a valid thing to say. That said, like I also like I can really see both points, right? Where it's like, yeah, like you there is always a certain amount that you have to learn about a topic, right? But I also think there's it doesn't mean that you should just say like, well, it's really Byzantine, good luck, have fun spending hours on Reddit to figure out what the stuff means.
Yeah, I mean, I understand that, but you know, I guess the thing is, I always come from a very cynical point of view too. I think that companies don't design things to make things easier for you necessarily, if they can make themselves more money. All for-profit corporations are designed to make more money, to maximize dollars. That's their mandate. They're chartered. They get yelled at and people get fired if they don't do that, because
I
that's
mean, it's not even corporations. I mean, like even when you hire somebody to, I don't know, fix your dryer, like they're not necessarily going to say like, oh yeah, you can save this much money by, you know, getting this part and doing it yourself. They're going to be like, well, that's me $600, and it's up to you whether or not to call three other competitors to see if that's actually a fair price.
Yeah, and most people, they call the first number, that person gives them a quote, like, okay, our heater went out. Like, I'm not going to call three other vendors and have them show up to, like, it's like 35 degrees outside where you're fixing it for
Yeah.
$500, right? But I just think that these companies want to just make money for you. They want to maximize, but I think people, maybe they're just, I think they're, it's a little unfair because it's not a 4090. It's not just called a 4090. It's actually called a 4090 uppercase L laptop GPU, right? And that's what it is. It's listed in specs. They publish the specs. It's all out there for everybody to see. It's not hidden. I mean, the fact is, everybody is so hung up on, would you really feel better if they called it 4090M? Would that really make it all better? Is that it? Really, is just simply calling it M. That's really gonna. For that uninformed buyer that goes out and they're just browsing, you know, at the store, they're looking at their phone, that M is going to tell them everything they need to know. I'm, you know, I.
I think so. I mean, I honestly think that just having some kind of different designation is enough to make somebody go, oh, wait a second, what does that mean? I should probably look that up. And it gives them something to search for more easily, right? Like I think if like I was coming into something, you know, and I didn't know anything about the topic, or I was like only maybe peripherally aware of the topic, I wouldn't know necessarily to go, hey, what does it mean when there's a RTX 4090 in a laptop versus a desktop? Like I don't even know what search terms I would use if I, you know, if I'm that novice enough or that unfamiliar with the topic. This has happened to me all the time. Like I'll have to go to a more experienced friend, you know, that knows about something more than I do and say like, so this thing is happening to me and I want to do my own research, so I'm not spending hours asking you questions, but I don't even know how to phrase this. And they'll say, oh, okay, this is the stuff that you need to put into Google's search bar to start researching that. And I say, oh, great, thanks. Now you've actually saved me however much time I'm going to spend, you know, spinning my wheels trying to even get to that point.
Would you though? I mean, like, but don't you, when you argue, like your, if your friend texts you and says, hey, I'm thinking about buying this laptop with a 4090. Well, one thing, you know, it's not going to be like $600, you know, Costco budget laptop. You know, this is like, this thing is like blinged out. No, I love Costco, but you're not going to get a
Costco.
It's not, you know what I'm saying? It's not going to be like, they're not like, oh, I'm really looking for the best, you know, they're not looking for something to do TurboTax on, right? If they're looking for a 4090 laptop, they're looking for the best performance they want, right? So clearly if you're looking for 4090, you want it because you've heard the buzz. If you buy a 4090 laptop GPU or based laptop, you are still literally getting the fastest thing out there, right?
So I think it's just a convergence of different viewpoints that some are naturally in conflict with each other, and some are it's an issue of a pragmatic outlook versus a philosophical ideal type outlook, right? So on the one, one branch of this, one vein of this is the whole like, okay, like we could put an M on there, or like maybe some other cool letter that we use, not X because everyone uses X.
It has an uppercase L, like you.
I'm just saying, right? Like, if you put that designation on there, it makes life a lot easier. However, from the perspective of, say, a company, if you label something like that, you are cueing people that it's different, which is kind of honestly a little bit against, you know, what psychologically they're hoping to do to you. I mean, in fairness, right? Like, that's the reason why businesses also put like it's $0.99 instead of saying, no, it's $100. No, it's $99.99 because they want you to think, oh, it's like $90. Cause like your brain just kind of anchors there as opposed to actually doing the math. Right. And that this is own whole separate conversation, or like at least another like spiraling down further into the weeds of like, is that right? You know, how should we legislate, you know, fairness and, you know, whatever, like that's some conversation, but that's one conflict that we're talking about. I think the other is just the whole, like, and this is just me being maybe a more of a, I need tangible things. I guess I'm a little stupid. Like I can't always operate in like the philosophical realm. Like there's a lot of times where I'm listening to people talk about benchmarks, like, you know, even earlier where it's like, it's a 13% uplift. And secretly, like, I mean, maybe not so secretly now because I'm admitting it, but sometimes in my head, I'm like, that's five frames. Like, yes, it's good. It's an improvement. And like, but in the range we're at, that's like five frames. Like, is it really going to make that much of a difference, right? So like that kind of speaks to your point here where it's like, this is still the absolute best you're going to get on laptop, y'all. Like it's not like we can take a desktop 4090 and just cram it into a laptop ourselves. It's not like we're being denied an experience that exists in somewhere, right? It's just like, that's what it is. So yeah, it sucks that it's like the naming's weird and like it's not analogous, but at the same time, like if you look at all the charts that you created, Gordon, like it's like 60% range, 70% range, over 100% range. Like this chip is nuts. Like this is the reason why I wanted to talk about this more so than the CPU side, because to me that's super exciting.
Oh,
it's
yeah,
just, like,
only 40%.
right? And
only 40% phone it in,
and more
Intel.
Importantly, we haven't even gotten to this point yet because I was kind of waiting like us to like get through this whole stuff, but I'm gonna bring it up now because like it's part of this topic I'm on, which is like this chip also fits into the craziest chassis now, like from my perspective, where it's like not even 4 years ago, like 3-4 years ago, you're talking about a 3-pound laptop. That's your productivity machine. Like you're just like, I'm going on a flight and I'm working on like basic Excel spreadsheets. Like that's all I'm doing on this, you know, 12-hour flight to Japan or wherever I'm going for work. You know, that's all you can expect out of your 3-pound laptop. Like it's a great, it's like a 360 spinning hinge. Like that's already amazing compared to what we used to have. I'm excited. You can fit an RTX 4090, like I wouldn't call it cut down, but lower TDP. So obviously the performance is going to be scaled a bit, right? But you can still get a 14-inch laptop. The Asus Zephyrus G14 is going to have a configuration with the RTX 4090 in it. And that laptop is like I looked it up, it was like 3.8 pounds. So it's a sub 4 pound laptop. Yeah. That freaking blows my mind, because it's not just the high end that this is like interesting. It means that what kind of laptops can we actually expect to see 4070s in, 4060s in? Like now when I take a 2 pound laptop to whatever business trip I'm fortunate enough to go on, does that mean like when I'm not doing work, I can be like, yo, boss, I'm off the clock, and like fire up a game and like actually be able to play it at, you know, settings that I'll actually enjoy, as opposed to like, no hate, Pat Brad, but like GeForce Now, great option, but not always the best on hotel Wi-Fi, right? Like,
yeah.
So I've kind of gotten off into my own like off the rails here, but that's just like, I just feel like we miss the forest for the trees when we talk about this kind of stuff. And I don't think anybody's wrong to point out the trees. I think it makes for a really great discussion among us. Like, we're all passionate about hardware, but sometimes just a little bit, I think we miss the forest for the trees.
Yeah, no, I agree with you there. Cause you know, again, the efficiency pickups from 40 series are pretty hefty, it looks like. Because if you're able to put that in a G14, although I think, although the TGP was higher than I expected, I think Asus said it was like maybe 100 watts. I forgot what it was. It was actually higher than I expected. But I will say, you know, again, we haven't done power testing and all that stuff. That'll come from a different chassis platform. But I will say this laptop, with its 330-watt power supply, I was running them side to side on a watt meter. They have different panels. This one has a mini LED. The other one had a, you know, an IPS. But running a GPU load on it, this one was actually using about 20 watts less. It's still, you're still looking at, you know, 280 watts. But, you know, it was using about 20 watts less than the previous 3080 laptop GPU. So 3080 Ti, kind of can't, it's really, and I'm trying to mentally always say laptop, because that's the thing, is technically, it is 3080 Ti uppercase L laptop. So instead of M, you have the laptop. If we all say laptop, nobody will be confused. But the fact that you're able to get 60% more performance in a pure GPU load, I think I was running Octane, on out of this laptop over the previous one, and you were doing it for a little less wattage, was like, it's kind of nuts. They're getting a very decent efficiency out of the 40 series over 30 series. And I think that's probably the one thing that's being lost in the usual kind of like hand-wringing over the naming of everything. So.
Yeah. Although I think, is it Davina in chat point out that on the opposite end of the spectrum, we have AMD, who went a little ham with their model numbers. So there's a balance to be had too with how this could be approached.
Yeah, I don't know if we can ever, I think companies are always going to adjust. My feeling is companies are always going to adjust their product stacks and names based on what they have to go to market with to sell you out of, to get them to maximize you giving your money. You just have to educate yourself and educate everybody who is asking you for information what to know, right? So that's just the best way, I think. So I just had to get that out there. I know, you know, I just think that you can't get away with it, because that's been said ever since the original 40 series laptop announcement at CES. That's what everybody said. The other thing is price, though. You want to talk about price?
Oh, I know. Everyone in the chat's already going there.
Yeah, so what price do we have, Gordon?
Well, so I think a lot of people are like, oh my God, the price increase. Let me just tell you this laptop. Let me read off the, this laptop with, this is a Titan GT 77HX. It's actually, this sample is actually going to be sold. There are some other reviews that may have the 13950HX. That SKU, as I understand, is not actually going to be sold. This will only be sold with the 980HX. So you're getting the 24-core Core i9 13980HX. You're getting that with the 4090 laptop GPU, 64 gigs of DDR5, 2 terabyte NVMe, Windows 11 Pro. That's also with a 4K mini LED screen, Oh, look at this. You're actually getting a USB key too. That's nice. 128 gig USB key thrown in. So again,
that's going to settle my decision. That's
going to settle it. But you're looking at a 17.3 inch 4K 144 hertz mini LED screen that hits HDR 100, right? 100% DCI P3. So again, not exactly a cheap screen. This laptop, killer, blah, blah, blah. You know, so the price of this laptop will be $4,600 on the street. So that's the list price, retail, right?
You said $4,600?
$4,600. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I was wrong. Yeah. Whew, I was totally wrong. It's $4,599. Because no, it's not $4,600. It is, yeah, $4,600. Let me tell you, I went and I looked up. It's like, huh? Because I heard people like, oh, my God, it's crazy expensive because it's pushing 5K. Yes, if you buy the version of this laptop with 128 gigs of RAM and a 4 terabytes of storage, you're pushing $5,300. This one is $4,600. But let me read off. I went looking. So the MSI GT7712 UHS that I did most of the testing against with the Core i9-12900HX with an NVIDIA GeForce RTX 3080 Ti, 64 gigs of RAM, 2 terabyte, basically similar. I looked, Micro Center said, slash on sale, $4,300 with it looks like the list price was $4,700. So it's technically looks like $100 less. Plus you're getting a mini LED 4K panel. Reactions?
Sorry, there's something happening in another window. One second.
Wait,
oh.
It was 43.
So basically, it was for the, if you, I actually included the screenshot just to prove it. For the 12th gen with a 3080 Ti, well, I'm sorry, I got that wrong again. It was $4,299.96. It was not $4,300. So, yes.
So we're looking at a price increase of about $300 between the two gens?
Well, okay, but that one is looks like the list price of that, according to Micro Center, was $4,699.97 of the previous one, obviously before the 13th gen and the 40 series existed.
Okay.
So this is $100 less on list price with the mini LED screen.
I mean, we've seen price creep in general from gen to gen, so that's kind of a separate conversation. I think the heart of this conversation, though, is just like, whoa, like, look at these prices, right? Or
well,
are we actually
yeah,
talking about gen to gen?
No, I mean, but I'm saying gen to gen. I think I want to make sure people understand that you have the facts. It does not look like going to 40 series, going to 13 gen, significantly increase the price over the previous version. Of course, that one was offered, what, a year ago? I mean, maybe supply chain, maybe demand had some play in that, but it actually did not go up in price. In fact, it actually looks like it went down about $100 in MSRP, yet you are getting a 4K mini LED, you know, 1,000 HDR 1000 panel. So that just needs to be out there, I think. So on the pricing discussions. So, no?
Yeah.
I mean, it does suck because it's like, but I guess I'd have to look back historically. I mean, you know, one thing I have noticed is laptops over the pandemic during during the shortages, I think it was very similar to what we saw with cars. You want to go out and buy a budget car? Huh?
Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
If you want to go out and buy a budget card, oh, tough. Go. Why don't you see that lake over there? We actually set up a springboard so you can go jump in that lake. We're not selling you a budget car. We are selling you the special edition car with the sunroof package, the leather seats, and all the doodads. Because by the way, we are going to sell that for a crap load of money. We saw that with cars. We see that in my stupid cereal, clothes, cars, everything. I'm just kind of wondering, that's just generally the pattern we saw over the last few years. And I'm kind of wondering, what would this laptop be 5 years ago? Or is it just simply because people are able to go out and pop off and buy $4,000 laptops? I don't know what's...
I don't know if you can really separate it out like that because there's so many different factors or influences from the past few years, you know, the pandemic, the supply chain issues, the difference in approach to hardware, right? Like where like it's just raw power, like let's just throw everything at it so that you get the absolute, you know, most rip-roaring piece of hardware out there. I mean, if you're a conspiracy theorist, you could also say, like, you know, the fact that they put a 4090 label on this allows them to, you know, say like it's more premium so that, you know, you can adjust pricing accordingly. There's a lot of different things mixed in there. I don't know if I personally would be able to separate out the pieces and go, yeah, like that's the reason why, that's the reason why, and like that's the reason why that we're seeing these changes.
Yeah, but I just want to point out, I don't really know if the price creep is just simply the price creep we've seen everywhere. I mean, it's
I mean,
like,
I think every company's going to take advantage of that to some degree. There are things that I'm seeing where I'm like, do you really need to raise the price on that? Like, you can't be moving that many units of that.
it makes you wonder, right? It does make you wonder because you would think eventually what brings prices down is like, ain't no one buying it, you know? And that's typically, but you know, we'll have to see if that ever that happens. But I do want to just make sure people understand going from the previous version to this one, it actually looks like it actually went down a little bit. So, and you're getting with a arguably probably a better panel too, right? Because this was a the previous version had a 360 hertz 1080p IPS, or I think it was IPS. I don't know. It might have been a VA panel, but you're looking now getting a mini LED 1000 nit panel, 144 hertz. So,
That's nice.
yeah, very nice. So I just want to point out on this particular model, I don't know if the screams are necessarily are valid. So
How
we'll have to
much
see with other ones.
did the laptop weigh again?
About 7 pounds, you know, basically that's without the power brick. So the power brick 330 watts is probably 2.5 pounds. It's you're going to feel it in your backpack, but you know, you're going to
Oh, yeah.
carry it to the hotel or wherever, set it up and call it a day, it feels like.
Gonna need to have Adam expenses so I can
Oh,
work and
yeah.
work at Computex and game at the
I
afterwards.
was just gonna say, I'm like, I feel like Willis is rapidly calculating in his head, like the different arguments in favor of having something like this available to our video team.
Or it'll be like, oh, you know, for $1,100 less, you can get a MacBook Pro 16-inch M2.
Well, I mean, for some things it's useful. There's definitely some arguments for it. Elena, would you say this is a, if I were to argue this is a crazy good deal, would that be wrong? At $4,300?
I
40, well,
mean,
$4,600, because you're getting 40% more multi-core performance. You're getting 60 to 100% more frame rates. You're getting mini LED panel,
all
1000
right,
nits,
so
4K,
here's the thing
144 hertz.
about me.
That's a killer deal.
I think everybody who listens to the show regularly kind of knows that I'm a little bit of a stick in the mud about word use. It kind of comes part and parcel of territory when it, you know, when you're a editor for a living. But I don't really like to use the word deal for things that don't relate to actual sales or like discounts or, you know, price reductions. I think it just kind of softens the meaning of that word. But I would say, I think that there's a lot of value that you're getting out of these high-end laptops. You know, like I don't think that you're spending necessarily $4,500 to $5,000 on a laptop just for aesthetic reasons or, you know, just like, well, it's a laptop, so you're gonna really have to like step down your expectations of what it can do. 'Cause I feel like that's more that we were looking at like 5 to 7 years ago, where if you got a gaming laptop, you're just like, well, like I'm sacrificing a lot for portability, so it is what it is. Like now you're getting really good performance. Like it's not cheap. It's not cheap. But I think that for the money you're spending, you are getting something in exchange for that money. So I would call that more of a good value for what you're spending on if you can make use of it rather than a deal. Like a deal to me is something that like you're like, wow, like I just have no reason not to buy it because it's like discounted. Like I'm not spending as much as I normally would for this. And like, even if I don't really need it, I could make use of it. So I guess I'll go ahead and splurge on it. Like to me, that's like more like deal territory.
So, let me summarize. So Elena is actually saying 40 series with 13 gen is a good deal.
Nope.
Good value.
Nope. I didn't say, okay, yeah. I think that for the right person, it has a lot of value. Like Willis.
It's good value, but for the price, not too sure. Not if I cheap. Spend, yeah, I'm not sure if
not
I want to.
Cheap.
Yeah, not cheap. I want to know. I need more, what was it, red envelope from Gordon, if anything.
Yeah, I'm just trying to obviously make people feel uncomfortable. We got any questions, Willis?
Yeah, let's get on to Q&A real quick. Let's see here. All right, updating slide. Real quick, just a reminder, if you have any questions for us, please add us on YouTube at PC World, and also you know for audio listeners and those who are catching up later on the stream, please send us the comments or the questions on the Full Nerd Discord as well. Let's see here. So we have a question earlier from this morning from Dark Helmet, asking recently Hardware Unbox had a video explaining why most reviewers perform gaming tests for CPUs benchmark at 1080p, which got them thinking, like, hey, the crux of it is that reviewers want to see how far given a CPU is capable of pushing a GPU. Is that correct, Gordon?
Yeah, the main, you know, I ended up tweeting a Hub's story. I think it was it both of them? I thought it was Steve that did the video. Steve Walton over at Hardware Unbox. Please also go over to Hardware Unbox, like and subscribe and click the smash bell button. Basically did a video showing the differences taking older CPUs and pairing them with newer GPUs. And it was in reaction to people going, why are you testing at 1080p? This is just simply not realistic. Or why are you testing with 4090s? And the reason you do it in a CPU review is because you don't want to run workloads, mostly games in that instance, that are CPU limited. So you would run a lower resolution to basically pretend that you had a 5090 or an RTX or Radeon, whatever, you know, 9900 from the future. So the idea is, like, you're advising people to buy a CPU, and in that case it was like, I think it was like 8700K versus a 2000 series Ryzen. What's better? Taking the video card of choice at the time, you would then run it at a lower resolution or lower game settings to go like, oh, this CPU is probably going to be faster when the GPUs get faster a few years from now. That's the rationale. People might run 1080p. They might run lower game settings or even lower resolution. A lot of people don't, but there's disagreement with that because they go, no, you should always run real world examples. Nobody in their right mind is ever going to pair a high end GPU with a low end GPU or CPU. And most, if you're buying a 4090, you're not buying it to play at 1080p. You're buying it to play at 4K. You know, so I think what it is just simply he was trying to explain to people why people do it that way. And it's not, if you need to see more validation of 4K gaming or this gaming or that gaming, please go look for that data elsewhere. But that is one valid way to give people insight to how fast a CPU might perform with the GPU from 5 years from now. That's the concept, and that's actually kind of what people did with the original Ryzen launch. And I will tell you, I've reviewed CPUs for a long, long time. You honestly, CPUs and games never really mattered before. Mm-hmm. A lot of that's because it was only Intel's world. But you would do like 720p, you'd run a few games and call it quits because it didn't really matter. It's obviously gotten more important with CPUs now. When the original Ryzen 1000 came out and people did 1080p testing, some people did 720p testing because that's traditionally how you had always done it. A lot of partisan fans got a little overly reactive to that. They start screaming at everybody, why are you so focused on 1080p gaming performance on Ryzen? You were intentionally doing this to make Ryzen look bad. Nobody's going to buy a 1080 Ti and run it at 1080p. That's just crazy, right? You're all going to be running high res 4K, whatever that was argumented. And of course, in the end, my feeling is like everybody's right. Some people tested at 4K only, which is a purely GPU limited test. I like after that feedback from everybody, I did like, hey, look, here's 1080p, here's 1440. And basically you could see at 1080, some of the CPUs would perform better. Intel, frankly, even with, you know, 8th gen would outperform its contemporary of the time from Ryzen. But, you know, I would run 1080p to say, hey, look, potentially the 8700K might be faster than Ryzen. But look at this. When I'm running this at 1440p, even with the 1080 Ti, it didn't matter because it was so GPU limited. So that is, in a nutshell, what he was trying to get at, because clearly Steve was tired of people biting his butt over why you were running the 1080p stuff. So I think he's right. I think everybody's right. Please try to see these benchmarks you're seeing here. See the benchmarks everywhere. Interpret it. Don't take everything as gospel. You need to protect your own wallet. You need to read everything and then buy the thing that's right for you.
All right. So as a buying guide, this is, you know, for both, you know, Elena and you, Gordon, that, you know, how do they know if like a CPU is holding back on their GPU?
Well, I mean, that's hard to say because you would actually have to do testing. I think this comes down to, you know, like if you were saying earlier, Willis, you were saying 10th gen, like, should I upgrade my 10th gen? So you have a 10th gen. If you had I don't know what you have, but say like you had a 3080, and should you upgrade is your 10 series holding back your 3080? It's going to come down to CPU, GPU, memory bandwidth, your also the things like the game you're playing, the resolution you're playing, the frame rate of your panel that you're playing, right? So those are all the different sliders that you're always going to be constantly juggling. I think the problem is like for the average person is like, I can't, how the hell am I going to simulate this? There's no way to simulate it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to say generally, if you only care about gaming, let me just make this rule up. If you only care about gaming, you're always going to want to, and I've been saying it for a long time, you always want to put your money into the GPU mostly, right? The GPU is always going to get you more smiles than a CPU. So if you have your 1080 Ti, say if you had your 1080 Ti and your 10th gen and you upgraded to a 13th gen, it's not going to get you as many smiles as taking your 1080, your 10th gen and pairing it with, say, a 4080.
Right.
I think if you took a 4080, you would get way more smiles than upgrading the CPU, even though that 10th gen is not going to perform as well as a Ryzen 7000 or as well as a 13th gen. Honestly, for most games, especially at higher resolutions, it's just going to give you overall, because I can't tell you what games you're running. I can't tell, there's just so many things.
Yep.
Most games put all the money into the GPU. Now, if you're talking like, I got a Devil's Canyon 4th gen CPU, and I got a, you know, and I have a, you know, what should I say? Like, what's a good CPU for a Devil's Canyon part? What are people running?
GPU, you mean?
Well, what do you think people would be running? Like, so like if you have a Devil's Canyon KB Lake, again, the very high clocked, most of those people would be probably running 10 series or 9 series.
I mean, let's see. I mean, I still have, I mean, Devil's Canyon, you're talking about a Haswell chip, right?
Yeah, Haswell.
Yeah, like, I feel like for most people, they'd probably at most be at 10 series. Like, I mean, I feel like what was really common back in the day was that a lot of people grabbed a 9 series card.
Yeah, so
and they just kind of stuck with that.
Yeah, so that's the weird thing. So like, you actually have like that system, you've been running it, now it's like, I need to upgrade. Oh boy. You know,
I mean, you are going to be very obviously GPU limited.
See, it's like it's one of those things where, yeah.
Yeah. But so here's the thing, too, though, like, and I think this is like a key, and this is me doing my whole like, but it's only 5 frames more. that's like that part of me where it's like the other key thing that a lot of people forget to take into account. So I think they get caught up in like the philosophy, like the numbers game of it, which is, is your system, even with like a 10th gen paired with a newer graphics card, Is it still getting the frame rates that you want? Because if it is in the settings that you want and the games that you want to play, you don't need to make any changes just yet. Like you can keep waiting, and that's actually a good game to play, like in a pun sort of way. That's like a good strategy to take because that means the longer you wait to upgrade, the more technological advances that you'll be able to take advantage of when you finally put down that cash for a new part,
Usually,
right?
yeah.
Yeah. I mean, if the trend keeps going the way it has been with these gigantic bars just
Right.
getting more gigantic, right? So, I mean, I think that's one key piece of advice that often gets left out of these discussions when we start talking. Because I'm like this too. Like I start talking about numbers and I'm like, yeah, like this, 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 this. And then it's like, wait a second, but are you happy with what you've got? Or like, are the games you're playing, are like, is it, are they performing exactly as you want? Are you able to crank up all the bells and whistles and still get, over 60, over 120, over 144 frames per second? Like you're kind of good to go, man.
Yeah,
Like
it's not a one size
live
fits fits
happy.
all. Yeah,
Yeah.
definitely. Because I like pretty graphics, so it's like I can just not have all the FPS and just stick with cranking up the graphics really high and just play it at 60 frames, and I'm okay with that.
Yeah, for like 10th gen, for you, if you had a 30 series, no, I wouldn't upgrade because that's crazy. I mean, gen to gen is always, even though there are huge differences between them, but it's usually pretty hard to justify. So, but looking at that example of like Devil's Canyon Haswell with a 980, whew, I don't know. I mean, I might.
I mean, you're probably feeling it at this point for sure
You're
with
probably
that
feeling
config.
it. I would
If
think
you play
like.
AAA games and you like to play like new AAA games.
Yeah, if you like to play new AAA games, I still think you would get more smiles out of, a 3070, right? 3060 Ti. Like I think you get like that's a huge upgrade. Yeah, is that old ass CPU holding it back? Yes. But you can still turn on more
Oh, yeah, for
features, you get
sure.
frame
Like,
rates
I
up.
think. In that scenario, yeah, I think if you're going to not do a completely new build and you're looking just for like incremental upgrades, GPU first, if gaming is your top priority.
But Davina points out like it's a mismatch. Don't put new cards in decrepit systems. I would say yes, because I was like, well, do you go like for an older used card? But then, with the prices being what they are, 30 series is kind of on its way out. You sort of figure you do the graphics card, 3060 Ti or whatever is a decent upgrade, and then you're going to eventually take that Devil's Canyon and throw it overboard. Give it to somebody else, and I think then you have a more modern card. So I kind of like the concept of doing something new, especially if buying used doesn't make sense. So,
I mean, in theory, it's nice to say, you know what? This is old. I'm just going to scrap the whole thing. Maybe bring along my power supply if I have a really good one that'll still last, X number of years. Maybe some of my storage. But realistically, a lot of us can't build that way. Like, I think for the crowd that's here that we're talking about enthusiast hardware that like are don't blink, double blink when we see some of these prices. Like maybe that doesn't seem as appealing as an option, but I think for a lot of people out there, what we've talked about here, what Gordon is saying, like that's honestly the path that a lot of people end up taking because they're just like, you know what, I could spend $1,200 on a whole new system right now, or I could spend $400 on a new graphics card. $800 still goes to my emergency fund because I'm a little worried about my job security, or I the prices of eggs went up, like things like that.
Next question from Antonio Zepat. Sorry, I'm butchering the name. So when, in your opinion, are we going to get a decent APU from AMD that we can run AAA sandbox games at stable 1080p 75 Hz monitor?
Wait, triple A what games?
Sandblock games.
Sandblock games. You mean
Even a
Minecraft?
sandbox?
I'm sorry, I don't know what that class of games are, but I do think, I really wouldn't expect a new APU from AMD this year, but you never know, because I mean they're obviously always evaluating what they have there, their inventory, what they got coming, so they could potentially do it this year, but I just can't see it. I still see APU as mostly a play for you know, entry level, lower cost systems. And that's really being serviced well, it feels like, by previous socket, previous parts. So I don't think it makes sense, but who knows, right? Because as we know, the internet will misunderstand what undershipping means, so that maybe they'll be under pressure to do it.
I would love to see a very powerful APU hit the market, but I feel like that's never say never. I don't see that fitting into AMD's plans for how they want to segment out their production.
Yeah. I just, because it's such a...
You also argue the whole, like, it's also going to potentially compete with console, even though it doesn't really. So it's kind of like, you know, you kind of... There's a lot happening that sometimes keeps us from seeing our tech dreams realized.
You know, I've been reading some, you know, internet rumors, which of course you don't know. That's like a coin flip.
No, Brad's not here.
They were saying that, I guess, Intel's big play. It was actually kind of a story. It was Tom Peterson was on from Intel, our team, by the way. We'd love to talk to him again. He was on some other podcast, and he was saying that it's kind of outlining some of their, you know, schedule, but it sounds like a lot of it is also focusing on APU, like, you know, basically better graphics in a CPU. So that I kind of wonder if Intel actually, you know, honestly, their graphics aren't bad, but in AMD's APUs are better. I kind of wonder if, like, it'd be cool to see Intel and AMD kind of go head to head on, like, making really good APUs. And I would consider an APU as a CPU intended for lower cost audience that has more performance on the graphics side, right? Because, I mean, classically, would you call 13th gen or 7000 APUs? I wouldn't, right? Because I really think it's like...
No. Yeah, those are so just, like, standard integrated graphics.
The monitors turn on. But although Xe is better than that, you know, so I do think... And you don't even get that there. But I do think that'd be kind of a really fun... I mean, good thing for consumers to get, like, man, you get Intel and AMD kind of duking it out.
Yeah. I think that's honestly where the nudge would have to come from, right? Like, having someone else compete with AMD on that. So if Intel could, I mean, they've got all the pieces now too, in theory, right? So if they could actually come out with something in that space and go, like, hey, here you go.
Yeah.
That could help, like, kind of light a fire on AMD where they're like, I guess we kind of have to respond to that.
Yeah, but the thing is just like, it's so cost sensitive. Like, you know, boy, this would be a great question to Ian, but do we expect 14th gen to have DDR4 support? Ian, he's in the chatter. Ian, will 14th gen have DDR4 support? Because I kind of wonder, like, the hard thing is, like, if you go DDR5, or they just kind of, when they launch into it, DDR5 is mostly supplanted it and gotten so affordable, it doesn't matter. Because ideally, they would just skip the DDR4 support. Oh, Ian says no. Okay, so... I guess that's probably when we'll see AMD APUs. You get, Ian says, if 14th gen is LGA 1700, yes. Oh, look, he's giving us hope. I was saying that maybe. If new socket, 14th gen, no. Oh, so we'll see.
I mean, there's like a weaning off process for DDR4 anyway, right? So eventually everything is going to move to DDR5. I don't think we can hope for the hybrid world forever.
I guess if Intel and AMD both did APU parts in DDR5, then they could both, like, they have cover for themselves. Then people couldn't say, like, why don't you do a DDR version? I can't afford DDR5. Then they both kind of like, oh, well, that's the future. Okay.
All right. See, from Tycho, do you have any insight on the Intel motherboard 2.5 gigabyte LAN issues? Does that affect all new Intel boards?
You know, I haven't looked into it. I've read a few stories. The complaints, I don't know if they're true or not, again, but there's definitely a lot of smoke there. The complaints are that the Intel 2.5 gig, these are actually Intel branded, you know, 2.5 gig Ethernet chips have this bug that they are occasionally disconnecting, and it's pissing everybody off. Looks like software has not fixed it yet. I don't know what the answer is on that. I don't know how valid the problem is, but again, there's definitely a lot of smoke. So there may be some problem. I don't know whether it's easily fixable through software, firmware, or whatever, or buying a PCIe 2.5 gig add-in card. I don't know what the answer is. Oh, wait. You know what? We have AI internet. Dr. Ian Kutcher says, my AI that is in the chat here, the Intel 2.5 gig issue should be solved now. The complaints were at launch should be solved with recent updates. Okay. There we go. There we go.
All right.
So for audio listeners, I just broke the chat because I picked up my kitty. I'm very sorry, everybody. I know I've been kind of visually distracting, just like checking on him. He wants his afternoon snack and he's been very disruptive.
Do you have the snacks on you so you can give the snacks now?
No, I didn't think we were going to go this long.
Oh, sorry.
It's been a while since I've
seen snacks. No shade. It's just, you know, he doesn't know that sometimes schedules change and he's an old guy now. So he wants it things when he wants things.
My dog also, our dog, comes up and looks at me like, where's the food? Where's the food? It's like, I'm not feeding you. Like the afternoon feed, that's one of the kids' responsibility. But he'll like come up to me, start pawing like, go bug somebody else.
All right, last one, Gordon. This is from our friend Liquid R, asking, hey, Gordon, you prefer to go karaoke, build a small form factor, or ride in the back of a coupe? Out of those three, who would you... Karaoke, build a small form
Such
factor.
A troll question.
or sitting in the back of my coupe.
I think sitting in the coupe is the least of the, because I know that only lasts for 30 minutes. You know,
it's a road trip, Gordon.
It's a road trip. So we're going to LA. We're going to E3.
Small form factor is going to be
the one you prefer out of the three.
Yeah, that's definitely. Wait for the entire parody item. But when I have the entire parody album written, we're going to do it. So I have an idea. Do you know, God, my brain is just not there.
You've had a long weekend.
It's a long week. I'm still trying to kind of stunned all weekend. Dan used to work at Future. Ghostbusters fan. God, what is wrong
Masoka?
With me?
Dan Masoka?
No. Used to work on one of the games.
Oh, the IT guy.
No. Magazine.
I don't know then.
Magazine Dan. He works at Ubi now, but I really wanted him to sing a parody of Threadripper when it first came out. But it would be set to Dreamweaver. So you take the music from Dreamweaver and you work in Threadripper lyrics. And then we're like, that's the first song. The second one is... You know, the Aerosmith song with the don't want to miss a thing without ray tracing. Like, that's like two. How many does it take for an album these days? Like, they drop albums all day now. Like, they'll come out of the bathroom, new album, right? Like, you just came out. Used to be like, what the hell is wrong with people now? Used to be like, oh, yeah, we had to wait like
what
years.
What the hell is wrong with people? Like, Gordon is the only person I know that complains that we have more entertainment in the world.
No, because it used to be like, yeah, I'm waiting for that new album from the Beatles. I never, of course, I didn't, because that's like before my time. But like, you would wait for a new album. It would be like years. They'd have to go to India. They'd have to have some phase, whatever, hookah, whatever. And the next thing you know, bam, new album. Now it's like, oh yeah, new album. They came out with a new album last week. How is there a new album already, right? Don't you notice that?
They're just that talented.
AI wrote it.
Yeah. See, like the whole Threadripper thing would be awesome.
Actually, Dr. Ian Kutcher's Tech Potato wrote a version of Aerosmith about ray tracing and put it in our Discord on the Full Nerd Questions.
So did he have AI write it?
I don't know. Let's see. Yeah.
Couldn't you see that? Just like
we should sing this when we go to Computex. Just put the music right, and then we'll come up with read the lyrics.
We should.
Off
We're
phone.
Gonna. We need another few songs.
Yeah.
So we got Threadripper. We got the Don't Want to Miss a Thing. Ray tracing. I don't know what else. I think it could work.
Journey. Don't Stop Believing. We can make it.
What would that be though? So like it'd have to be some kind of. It's got to be something super impressive or meme worthy. That's the thing is like, I guess you'd have to take a song and like maybe 40, so the 40, 80, 12 gig would be another like cringe one, I think. That was like everybody that caused everybody to freak out.
What would you layer that onto? What song would you layer that onto, though?
12 volt high power. What would be like a good the whole 12
melting cables?
Yeah, but what would be the song it would be? Because it's gotta have a good song. When you think of like I don't want to miss a thing, but ray tracing, that's like it totally writes itself. Threadripper and Dreamweaver writes itself. So we need the songs.
Oh, he said he wrote it in the chat GPT with the phrase write lyrics about AMD Ryzen chips to the tune of Happy by Pharrell.
Now we would get sued. We would get sued because probably somebody like Getty's gonna like, I don't know, you're like,
no, you gotta pay for the sampling, right? That's my gosh. Yeah. Music now just samples from everything. Everything is just one big
Well, that's how they
plot.
Do their new album. Oh, so you're complaining
that's
about
how
the
they
sampling.
I enjoy more entertainment, but it's kind of like Hollywood recycling the same story over and over again. Like, I like new stuff too. I like new stuff too.
Kel from Falco Northwest checking in. What did we miss? Hey, you missed everything.
Everything.
We're writing an entire nerd parody album here. We already got two.
Oh my gosh. We should do that. We should make it like a tech tuber thing where like each like channel like does their own thing and we just put it on like a charity album in Spotify or something.
So the problem with that, I'm bringing up the Maximum PC podcast. I just want to bring this up.
Here we go.
We had, do you remember the singing podcast? This is Will Smith's idea. He had, it's like, let's do a singing podcast. So he had everybody sing songs for this. I think it was the 100th episode of the Full Nerd Pod, not the Full Nerd, but the Maximum PC podcast, no BS podcast.
Okay.
Everybody would sing. I said, hell no, I am not singing. I am not doing this. I'm not. I refuse to
just
do it.
Hum the harmony in the background. That's what I'm going to do because I can't sing.
The complaints were epic. Because let me tell you, if Will Smith, like, I mean, our Will Smith, not the Will Smith guy. I mean, our Will Smith.
Just don't smell.
Not going to sing. You don't want to hear Will Smith sing. You don't want to hear Nathan Edwards sing.
I do.
There was a lot of pushback. Mistakes were made. So we got to the 200th episode of the No BS podcast. We never did it. We just did not do it.
He wasn't getting jiggy with it.
I think the pressure was they wanted like another singing episode or something epic. I'm like, we are not going to do a singing. I'm not going to sing. You don't want to hear singing. But yes.
All right.
We gotta go. Elena's got to feed the cats.
I know.
Yeah. Right. Sorry, everybody. We're being.
No, no. Thank you for getting here. I know you had an epic night. There's hardware. Hey, you know what? This is my last message to everybody. You wanna just gnaw on Steve Walton's ass from Hardware Unboxed over something, or get on Jay or Linus or Steve over Gamers Nexus, or just call that guy Gordon, the dumbass he is. Oh, why would you do this? That's fine. But remember, it's hard. Reviewers hard as life. You got to say, like, first, thank you for doing this test. Let me tell you why you did it all wrong. But at least first say, thank you for your test. Because everybody, when you do launches, You are burnt and it never ends. So look, everybody's opinion is valid, but please say, thank you for running the test. Here's why it's all wrong. That's at least say that first. So that's my,
so please that's listen my to the whole thing. Or if you're on the website, read the whole thing.
Read the whole thing too. Yes. And of course, read the whole thing and then go and then say, here's my input for the next time you do it. Here's why you should consider this instead of simply going to 11 and shouting. So just remember that, especially after the launch, because then people ain't got, that fuse is like 1 millimeter long. Don't do it. Don't do it. And check back next week for your fix of PC Talk on the Full Nerd. For audio listeners, subscribe to us on iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, or Stitcher. And if you're on one of those services, please leave a review. Every time you do, some YouTuber will pop off at you for complaining about doing their testing after they have survived 1 week on 3 hours of sleep. Send questions and comments to thefullnerd@pcworld.com. Somebody might check it one day. Thanks for coming. I'm Gordon Ung with Elaine E.
Bye, everyone.
Splat. Splat is gone.
Meow.
Oh. And Willis is going to take us out.
All right. We are going to take song requests, please put them up on on our Discord channel.
I want
to the suggestions. We'll try to, you know, have Gordon sing his heart out on when we get to Computex, or we could go to a karaoke place in Oakland somewhere.
Oh yes, know? If there's enough, ooh, maybe we'll do it there. And then we'll record it, and people will understand why you don't want to see. You never want to hear people sing karaoke.
But if we go to like a Korean barbecue place and have enough soju, like I don't think we'll care at that point.
Yes. That sounds like a plan. All right. Well, we'll wait for those comments then. All right. Until then, everyone, have a good day. See you later.